You might have thought that the number one touring band in the United States would be a bunch of baggy pants hip-hoppers or some heavy metal demons from the seventh circle of hell. But the number one live band, with almost $250 million in ticket sales, is this multiracial, multi-musical act known as the Dave Matthews Band. How popular are they? This past summer, they sold out three shows at the huge Giants football stadium in the New York City area. An amazing feat for any band. With their odd collection of instruments and their odd collection of songs, the Dave Matthews Band sounds just a little bit like a lot of acts. But a whole lot like no one else in popular music. The band members insist they never planned it that way. In fact, they never planned anything at all. Bassist Stefan Lassar.
I never really knew what to expect. Once we started filling clubs and moving on to bigger spaces and to theaters and then, you know, amphitheaters, and started to think, wow, okay, this is really interesting now.
Violinist Boyd Tensley.
I was blown away from the very beginning. And I remember when I went home to my fiance and I said, you know, I just came from the most incredible band I've ever seen in my life.
Saxophonist Leroy Moore.
It's amazing it could have come together because everyone is so different. It's sort of strange. And it's a pretty cool bunch of guys. And how I ended up in here, I don't know.
10 years ago when we started out, it was a scary thing. It sounded like absolute crap.
Drummer Carter Beaufort.
It sounded terrible. It was the worst thing I've ever heard in my life.
Guitarist, singer, and songwriter Dave Matthews.
People have said that, how did you plan this? Did you go out thinking, I want a violin and a saxophone? And it was nothing like that. The first couple of times, admittedly, it was pretty awful. But within 6 months of us being together, we were all real aware of the fact that we had something that was beyond all of us.
Tonight, the story of Dave Matthews and the Dave Matthews Band and the journey to a highly anticipated new album.
From New York, a special edition of Charlie Rose.
Find the roots of the happy accident that became the Dave Matthews Band, you drive to Charlottesville, Virginia, hard by the home of President Thomas Jefferson. It is also the home of the University of Virginia and a melting pot for young musicians who play the frat houses and the bars. You want jazz? They've got jazz. You want bluegrass? They've got bluegrass.
Tried to join the infantry, every post was manned. Tried to join the cavalry and ride a final stand. Tried to join artillery and blow up in my hand. Threw down all my weapons, left them.
You want reggae? They've got reggae. For locals, like violinist Boyd Tensley, it was a fusion freak's dream.
We have folk musicians there. You know, the jazz guys come down to sit in on the rock guys' gigs. The rock guys come in and sit in on the jazz guys' gigs. And it's kind of like, that's the normal way things go down there.
Finished high school. I lived in New York for a little while, and then I moved down here, followed my mom down here, yeah. And my family in 86, at the beginning of 1986.
Charlottesville was a comfortable fit for Dave Matthews, too. Its cultural and musical diversity, as well as its laid-back beauty, reminded him of his native South Africa.
And when you think of home, when you think of, you know, home, do you think of here? Do you think of South Africa? Where do you think?
Well, I think more and more it's making its switch to here. For a long time, it was sort of South Africa. I did have this part of myself that thought I'm still South Africa. And I do in some ways go back there to find to find the roots of things, to find a quietness that maybe find a separation. But but Charlottesville is much more my home, I think. Much more now than ever. Oh, hey, nice to meet you, sir. All of us, the fact that we all still live here, you know, no matter what success we've had.
And we used to be friends till this moment now.
We all stayed here. The guys in the band, very shortly after I moved here, didn't meet them all, but I heard them all playing.
And he had heard them all play while working at a local bar called Miller's.
And Dave was a bartender. In fact, I'm not sure really when he started bartending there, but he worked there. I guess he was like making salads or waiting there or something.
Yeah, I was a bartender for a few years, a waiter for a few years, a salad boy. For a few, that was reverse order. First I was salad boy, then I was waiter,
and then I was a bartender. Yeah.
And we just started sort of hanging out, talking, like late at night after performances and stuff. You know, everybody'd be gone, we'd be hanging there, drinking whiskey and talking. And at the time, I just was starting to get sort of educated about South Africa and the whole situation with apartheid and just the whole deal. And it was really interesting, you know, all of a sudden there's this dude from South Africa. But I didn't even know that he was a musician, or I really had no idea. Till later, you know.
We weren't too sure about this guy, you know. We're like, well, he has some pretty, you know, happening stuff here, but we weren't sure if he was gonna, you know, come across as a top-notch musician. Well, he proved us wrong.
When I talk to some of the guys, they think that your experience in South Africa is reflected in your music. Do you?
Yeah, I can't imagine that any major experiences don't affect our outlook, and just on a really simple level.
You heard sounds and you saw things. And
yeah.
Dave Matthews was born 33 years ago in a suburb of Johannesburg, where he spent much of his youth fully aware of the joys and injustices around him. There is more than a faint echo of his homeland in the music he creates.
The music there is so unusual. That directly is obviously the comparison. I think that I would have to have had both hands and stuffed in my ears and in order to avoid getting some sort of inspiration from it. I wish that the world could see the sides of Africa that are not what is televised in the news, you know, famine and war is all we get to see because that's apparently what sells. There's a spirit in the people, and I can't speak for all of Africa, but in Southern Africa, music is a celebration of the richness of life so often in Africa. And when I go to a little town to visit a friend in Soweto and see poverty, you know, in a material sense, see someone who doesn't have enough beds for the people in his family, and yet see someone who has so much more wealth of spirit than so many people when I come to America. I go back to Africa all the time to see that, to be reminded of that. And my mom always says, whenever I play her a song, or maybe not always, but very often, she says, well, always reminds me of South Africa when you play, you know, when I play. She says it's always reminiscent, sometimes more obviously than others.
I need so to stay in your arms, see you smile.